First, a word of thanks to Dr. Ganeshan and the organizing team of the Alana Institute of Management Studies for inviting me. Also, Mr. Rajpal, who had a no small part in that, in making it possible that I would be here to share and be with all the young people here. So what am I going to do? A lot of you would not have heard of electrical and automation, L&T, and L&T is all about projects and airports and bridges and roads and where does this guy come from, right? We come from the product part of L&T, and we are the only product part in L&T, okay? It's sort of expected that we guys will come up with a lot of innovation and stuff like that. And the company looks to us to be very innovative because we are, after all, a product company. The rest of us are contractors, they tell us. Okay, we build bridges and stuff like that. But actually, when we have a lot of discussion, when we start writing our sustainability report, it's my job to tell them, but actually you guys also do a lot of innovation, the way you construct bridges and the metros and all that. Okay, let me just tell you a little bit about electrical automation. Yeah, the next slide, I'll change from here. Yeah, so we are electrical automation. We have 8 S&Ds, just the electrical automation part, 4 SBUs. We have 15 factories which make everything, and 8 subsidiaries. So we have 6 factories in India and about 7 factories abroad. And we have 4 design centers, right? So this is in substance. So we are a very spread out organization. We are the leading manufacturers of low voltage switchgear. We are the number one in India as far as low voltage switchgear is concerned. Okay, and that's our spread across India and the world is, and that's our global footprint. A lot of people know about us. Our biggest friends are our farmers. I don't know how many of you come from a farming background. All farmers will tell you about the MK1 direct online starter, right? They swear by it. So much so that we can't do any innovation on the product. We can't even change the color of the product. We can't change the screw on the product because the farmer will say that's a fake one. Right. So it's a 60-year-old one, almost more than 60, around 60 years old. And when Mr. Hawk Larson was alive, and one of his last trips, he went to one of, and Mr. Larson was a customer friendly. Even in the last stages of his career, or even after he retired, he would go and meet our dealers and our farmers, and he would be shocked. You are selling the same product at this price. He would be totally shocked and go back. Right? It started when he was in the field. So there is one issue about that, but. As a company, we have a tradition of a strong new product development system. We file about 150 patents every year around our products. That's a bit of our background. And over and above that, we have a number of continuous improvement ideas which we encourage from our employees. So what I'm talking about is the fact that we are a very innovative company. We encourage innovation among our employees and our engineers. Across the organization, we have one definition of innovation, and that is the profitable implementation of ideas. Now, profitable because you are a corporate, and it's not just about ideas. Innovation is actually implementation of ideas, right? And so we have a process for helping people take their ideas to the marketplace and make it a profitable implementation. So why is innovation so important? Not only for electrical automation, for all of us. Right? And let me just look at quickly at that. Why focus on innovation? First of all, is that to create profit. Right? We need to create new value. Right? An organization cannot stay where it is. It has continuously to create new value. So these are the 4 P's which I put together. People, right? And people in the sense that innovation is a very key thing for us to build employee engagement. We empower employees to come up with ideas, to be engaged. Innovation is not just for some people sitting in the R&D department, right? So innovation focus is there because it's a very strong engagement initiative. Prosperity, yes, it gives us, look at business opportunities, gives us innovation. Culture really helps us to see a clarity and a strategy. And of course, the 4th P is a little bit of what I will be talking about. Is the planet issues, right? Innovation addresses broader challenges facing society itself, right? So therefore, there is a lot of focus on innovation to address these 4 P's, right? let me just try to explain the clarity opportunity, right? There's a lot of opportunity out there, and for an idea, we may not have much clarity about the opportunity at the initial stage. But over a period of time, the opportunity, the clarity of the opportunity becomes better. But what happens is that the opportunity value itself decreases, right? And maybe 5 years from now, or I should go back. Yeah, 5 years from now, you may have a very good clarity of the opportunity, right? The good market value there and the good market opportunity there. And then at that point, you start to actually implement the idea. By then what happens? The opportunity value comes down, right? What happens with innovation and building an innovation culture in the organization is that you instead of year 5, it could be year 3, right? And that's why innovation is important, and a culture of innovation people engaged with innovation is very important, because you capture the larger market opportunity, right? So this innovation is important to really for the prosperity part, to capture the large opportunity which is out there. Okay, all of you management students would know about the S-curve, and I'm not talking too much about it. But where do you start the S-curve is very important, right? Now we have drawn the S-curve there. Do you think it's a good place to start your S-curve? What do you think, the management students? I'm not a management student, I'm an electrical engineer, okay. Yeah, you can't start an S-curve at that point, because what happens, you're a market leader, right? You are trying to protect your market leader position. You don't have money to invest. You got to start your S-curve much towards the left, right? And innovation is actually in any corporate is to generate as many S-curves as early as you can, because what happens towards the right side, right? It's declining. You have issues of finance, etc. The point I'm trying to make is many organizations, including electrical automation, we are market leaders for many years now, decades. And what happens is that we tend to get into a position of complacency, right? A market leader, I'm sitting on the top of the curve, and I look forward, what do I see? I see downhill, right? If I don't generate a new S-curve. So sometimes being a market leader is the most dangerous position to be. Right? It's comfortable, but if you look forward and if you're not innovative, if you're not having an innovation culture, you're going to see things coming down. And that is the reason why we focus so much on innovation in E&A. Not only the R&D department, but across as a culture. Okay. Basically saying you can't sit on the lid of a progress. If you do, you'll be blown to pieces. Right? That's the truth which all corporates now realize. And this is something what Vijay Govindarajan talks about. And you look at any organization, it's basically in any one of the three boxes. They're either managing the present, right? They got to do a little bit of forgetting the past. But the last one is what we talk about a little more. And that is every organization has to create the future, right? Every organization has to create the future. Not that they will manage the present, but creating the future is something which everybody needs to do. And you look at every organization, they would be spending some part of their money and time and resources in all these three boxes. If they're not doing that, they're sitting on top of the curve, right? And they're looking into a future which is downhill. So we need to have innovation of all types. We need to have breakthrough innovation. We need to have incremental innovation. And that's how we build over a period of time when you look at the corporate as such. So I'm talking more about the creating the future. How do I look at the future? First of all, you need to look at the weak signals. What is a weak signal? As in electrical field, there was a time when you bought a refrigerator, the only thing you would look at is how much money do I have in my wallet, right? 15 years back, that's the only thing. After some time, people started talking about energy efficiency. And they said, what's the wattage, etc. That's just people started talking about it. After some time, what happened and what is the situation today? Every appliance, white good, needs to have a star efficiency label. It's mandatory, right? Organizations which did not look at the weak signals and asking, look at the what questions customers were asking, were caught on the wrong foot, right? Ditto in the automobile industry, and I'm not talking on that because somebody from the automobile industry is there. One fine day, Mr. Kejriwal wakes up and says, no more diesel vehicles, and everybody scrambles around, right? But the, so where did it come from? He didn't get it on his own. It came from society when they said there's so much pollution and diesel vehicles and all that. So the weak signals, organizations need to have a setup to capture that, right? And to see the weak signal, to receive the weak signal requires a culture where there is innovation, there is a culture of trying, experimenting, coming up with new things, right? The weak signals can come from anywhere. It could come from customer changes, it could come from technology, discontinuities, non-traditional competitors, it could be new distribution channels, and regulatory changes. The last one I gave an example, the 5-star or the mandatory star rating on appliances. But look at customer discontinuities. Customers can change. You can get a totally new set of customers coming up anytime, right? Technology discontinuities, I don't have to tell you, right? From technology, and nowadays, if you give an example of our circuit breakers, I will tell you what circuit breakers do now, which never thought of doing earlier. Non-traditional competitors, right? Everybody knows the example of the major competitor to airline industry, people like Cisco, right? Who can make travel unnecessary. Right, at least business travel is unnecessary. You can have video conferences, Skype, this, etc., etc. Right, so non-traditional competitors can, you know, weak signals can come from there. And new distribution channels, right? We in electrical automation have a very wide network of stockists and dealers going up to the village. It's been there for the last 60 years, right? And we take pride in the fact that we built it over 60 years, right? Who's there? Who can say, somebody can come and say, I can get you everything on switchgear on Amazon, right? And there goes our competitive advantage, right? And so we need to build in not just the traditional brick and mortar distribution channel, but also we should have the Amazon type of distribution channel, right? So these can trigger, right? And these are the weak signals which can come. So this is our circuit breaker, just an example. Right, it's a circuit breaker. How many electrical engineers by any chance in this group? Oh, good. Now, circuit breaker is breaks a circuit. Okay, I'm trying to make it very simple. I've been in training, and one of my jobs was to train mechanical engineers, and I have done programs for mechanical engineers and non-engineers. I have training program for finance account specialists. That's great fun to have electrical engineering training program for finance guys, right? And I can never get to switchgear. They will ask me, how does this bulb work? How does the fan run? I said, I come to teach you switchgear. Anyway, so typically it is, a circuit breaker is one which breaks the circuit when there is a fault, right? Right? And so it tricks, now it can be a very simple device, but over the years it has turned into something which is, which can communicate, right? It not only trips, it communicates, it gives you an indication when it is going to trip, when there's an overload, it's heading towards overload, it's 10% short of overload, your plant is running 10%, you're heading towards overload, the maintenance engineer gets a message on his mobile saying that the load is increasing, right? It's going to trip and shut down your plant, do something, shut off some loads, right? So a simple circuit breaker is now integrated with communication, signaling, metering, whole lot of things. It talks to all the other circuit breakers and other equipment in the factory, how much it has changed, right? So that's one example of that. So it talks about a multiple number of things which can be built into this device. In case I will not go into great detail because you may not, just to give a flavor of how things have changed over a period of time. The other thing is how products have become more compact. Gram per ampere, products have become much smaller and smaller. Earlier it was 60 grams per ampere for a particular product called a contactor. Nowadays it's 13.6 grams per ampere, right? The weight of the product has, why? What is the big deal in that? We use less material. So what's the big deal in that, right? we work, we live in a world where resources are going to finite. It might happen in the lifetime of those sitting that side, I think, right? The student's life, right? It can happen. Silver, copper, aluminium is all just limited now, right? When we started our career in working, the presumption was infinite amount of material there. Go there and dig it out, right? There's enough of mountains to dig for aluminium, right? You can get it. No longer, right? Fine. So that's just an example of. So talking about the people part, Einstein said it very well. Innovation is everybody's responsibility, not just the R&D. So that's where it is. And so when you're talking about creating the future, you need to look at the issues of sustainability. Now I handle sustainability, innovation, and CSR. A very strange combination, but gives a lot of scope for a lot of wild ideas. Anyway, so some of the biggest things which was mentioned today was also the fact that climate change, right? All of you are aware of climate change? It's not Greek and Latin here?
Yes, sir.
This side is saying climate change. That side?
Yes.
All of you are aware of climate change? Yeah. So climate change is a big issue, right? You cannot allow the average global temperatures to go beyond 1.5 degrees centigrade. Water is a big scarce resource. Whether you're making electronic chips or fertilizer or whatever, water is a big issue. Depleting natural resources, increasing mountains of waste everywhere, right? And urbanization. I've just put some things here, right? These are some of the issues, globalization. So we work in a very complex business environment, right? Is it good or bad? Then I'll ask you later. And all of this, mega forces are driving business, correct? So, point number one thing which we may have to throw, most MBA students will have to throw out of the window, is traditional strategic planning, right? We take past data, sort of extrapolate into the future. But what does the future look like? That's what I talked about. Resource scarcity, climate change. The future is changing rapidly. You can't predict 5 years from now what's going to happen. And what is your 5-year strategic plan going to look like? Right? You've got to look at scenarios. A scenario where there's no water, Cape Town, okay? And I heard Bangalore is also on the list. A scenario where there is no water, how will you do business? What happens to your strategic plan? Right? These things need to be looked at, right? And I tell people that these are huge challenges. And so what we're talking about is arguably the greatest challenge to innovation that humankind has ever faced. We've got to reinvent our whole way of living, right? So one thing which sometimes when you go through a conventional degree or college degree or a new engineer join our company, right? I tell them this is the most exciting time to start your career, right? To start your career in industry or wherever. Because your mandate is what? Reinvent our whole way of living. You can't do what we all did. People of my age group did. We cannot do, right? There is no resources in the planet to do it, right? And so although I made a big issue about those challenges, it's an excitement to you that you can work on something fantastic. You can basically reinvent the world, right? So it might look very difficult, but creativity, great thing is technology is out there. You only got to connect the dots, right? He talked about connecting people, connecting technologies, connecting markets, and you got to work with a network of innovators. That's why I'm also happy to be here with institutions. Ideas, some of you may have great ideas. And I've been to places where people have great ideas of taking waste into a resource, right? Ideas can come from any one of these places. We did a challenge with IIT Tech Fest, and we put out a challenge there. We called it IoT in agriculture, right? And we got an idea which is basically to do with sensing moisture, which is a 1/10 the cost of what is available worldwide, right? An amazing idea which came from the Tech Fest. We put a challenge out there among the engineering colleges of India. So we can only connect the dots that we collect, right? So we need to find those dots. Connect those dots. The dots are with people, institutions, ideas, markets, customers, products. Dots are all there, right? You don't have to reinvent the wheel, right? You got to simply connect the dots, right? Skip that. I'll skip this video because I don't have enough time. Disruption often comes from outside your sector, right? Basically, that slide talked about one idea, which is we are used to take, make, dispose, right? We're talking now about a circular economy where the waste becomes a resource for somebody else, right? Copying nature. So disruption often comes from outside your sector. So just connecting the dots. Here an example of this. This is a, have you seen this example? Yeah, I just finished. This is a conventional CT machine. Kids are very scared to get inside this machine. Why not give an app, why not take, ask Walt Disney to come up with a new design of a CT machine? And this is the CT machine, very colorful, designed by Walt Disney guys, right? And the kids are no longer scared to get inside. So connecting is what we need to do. Leonardo da Vinci did it, right? He had knowledge in multiple fields. He used to connect different fields. When he came up, he even had the design of the helicopter. And Richard Branson also, when he talked about, his equation of life is A plus B plus C plus D, always be connecting the dots. You don't have to invent a new thing. Okay.